Good morning. Good morning. Hello. Good morning. It is good to have you all here for worship today. I am using a mic just for the first few minutes of this service because I made a little fatal mistake and didn't get over to get my mic and my batteries and whatnot. So are y'all gonna start with your, okay. Welcome to Everybody's Church, which as you know, we commit ourselves to serving Christ by cultivating mission, inclusion, and community. And the good news in our community this week is, well, first of all, today there is a rejoicing spirit service. If you haven't been, you want to go. They are amazing. You may have seen or heard the online, or got the online announcement that on May 21st, we will have one service and we will have the opportunity to hear the candidate for our pulpit. And then of course after that service there'll be some book of order things that need to happen. But what you may not know, hopefully you saw the message online, is that on the Saturday before that from 3:30 to 5 there's going to be an opportunity to meet that candidate here at the church. And you're encouraged to do that. This is also Foster Care Awareness Month, and the deacons have designated donations this month to help out the children in foster care. You can see the list in your bulletin of the items that are needed. Currently, there are over 10,000 Michigan children involved in the foster care system. So anything you can do to help is really much appreciated. Next week, for those of you who are wondering, we will have a young man named Justin Black to bring our message. He and his wife wrote a best-selling book that's called Redefining Normal, and it's about their life in foster care. So you will have the pleasure of hearing Justin give the message next Sunday. And now, let us worship God.
Thank you. Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. Christ, being risen from the dead, dies no more. Hatred and death have no more dominion over him. The way of love has become our way to a new life. Rejoice, again I say rejoice.
And will the young people come and join me up in the front? Good morning. Good morning. How are you guys doing today? Any good news that any of you guys have in your lives? No? Nothing? Not really? Just everything's pretty much okay? You got cheese? That's interesting. And yeah. Well, some people really like cheese, and that's okay. I have to confess, cheese doesn't last long at my house, so I'm kind of with you there. Well, when you have something really good in your life happen, how do you feel? You feel good, yeah. Do you just, you know, go in your room and smile? Or what do you do when good things happen? Any thoughts? No thoughts? That's how I am every day. But actually, when something good happens for me, I like to tell people about it. Hopefully not obnoxiously. But I like to tell them about the good things going on in my life. And guess who else felt that way about sharing the good news? Any guesses? Go for it. Well, Jesus was the good news, wasn't he? The disciples, absolutely, the disciples shared the message. And we are in Eastertide, which is the weeks after Easter, and we're always telling the story of Jesus because it's so amazing. And after Jesus came and visited them in the upper room and then eventually went up to be with God in heaven, the disciples gathered together and they started to pray and work together. They shared things and they took care of each other. And they did all of that because they were so grateful about the news about Jesus. So, what can you do? We could help people. Wow, that's a very great idea. Anything else? Yes? I didn't quite catch that, my old ears. What did you say? Well, I know it was a beautiful answer and Jesus heard it. I didn't quite catch it, but, and how about you? What can you do? Help your dad clean the dishes. I don't know where you are, Dad, but you've got a helper here, and that is phenomenal. Yes, and how? You can celebrate. There's a whole lot of ways that we can care for others, and we can celebrate the good news. And one of the other things that we can do is we can pray. So I'm actually going to invite you. Let us pray right now. And I'll start. You can follow. Loving God, we give you thanks for our church family and our families of origin. We pray that all will be well with them and that we can be a part of caring for them with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, so those of you who are heading out to class. Well, my beloved church family, today is a little chaotic for me. So I'm going to invite you to join me in settling down for just a moment and turning our hearts to God in our time of confession. We often want to hide our sins and forget about our failures. But that's not what God wants. God wants us to come forward and confess our sins, our failings, so he can make us fresh and new. So let us join together in our unison prayer of confession. God of the resurrection, we confess to you that it is hard to believe in Easter. After the Easter eggs are eaten and we are fully chocolate, we confess that our fears of daily living remain. We are overwhelmed by the wars and the hatred around us and in us. We look at the suffering and injustice in the world and hope strangely in our hearts. Forgive us, O God, and through your triumph over the Roman cross, raise us up to a new hope and a new life in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And hear us now, Lord, as we pray to you in silence. Amen. It's amazing news. It is so great. I think sometimes we can hardly believe it. Brothers and sisters, in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. We are made whole and new, and we can go out and share the peace and love of Christ with one another. Alleluia and amen. You are forgiven.
Let us pray together using the printed words of our prayer for illumination. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
May the Lord grant that we may engage in contemplating the mysteries of God's heavenly wisdom with really increasing devotion to His glory and to our edification. Amen. Our first reading is from Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47. You may follow along with the reading on page 121 of the New Testament in your pew Bible. Listen for the word of the Lord. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Awe came upon everyone because many wonders and signs were being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and goods and distribute the proceeds to all as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at home and ate their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. The word of the Lord.
Yeah. Well, if that shouldn't bring you out of your seats, there ain't nothing going to bring you out of your seats. I want to thank you very, very, wow, that was great. I would never, ever have, if I was pastor, have the choir sing before me. I mean, if you really blow the sermon, then the choir can pick up and you can go home and everybody feels good. But now, if I blow it, I'm in trouble. I mean, wow, this, I don't know. Not fair, that's all I know. So, our gospel lesson reading. Thank you. I told you, if you blow it, okay. Our gospel, of course, I can't see the text at this point, but that's okay. Our gospel readings from the gospel according to John chapter 20. And I really do want to say, I do know this is not Easter Sunday, but we're still in the Easter season. And so that's the reason I'm using this scripture. And John writes, when it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And after this, he showed them his hand and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when that Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hand and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. And although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." And Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and have yet come to believe." And then John concludes, "Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name." Well, I worship at Groves Hill Presbyterian Church on most Sundays, and on Easter Sunday was a marvelous occasion. The congregation was filled with worshipers. Now, you have to remember, we had sunshine. We didn't have rain like you all had to put up with today, but we had sunshine, and it was a gorgeous, and the choir. We have a great choir too, and they sang the Hallelujah chorus, and then they took time so that we in the congregation could join in the Hallelujah chorus along with the choir. I mean, I've always wanted to sing in the choir all my life. No one has ever asked me to sing, but they asked me that Sunday. It was a joyous occasion. On Easter, we celebrated not only the resurrection, though, we celebrated also the end of the winter blues. We celebrated the arrival of spring, the entrance of those daffodils and those irises in my garden. And then we went to the park, and marshmallows were dropped from helicopters, and bunnies brought chocolate, eggs. Now you can't get any better than that. I mean, that is one day that you really can't forget. And we are still celebrating that Easter season, which is why I'm wearing white on this Sunday. But then, on the second Sunday of the Easter season, and the third, and the fourth, and the fifth, reality begins to reassert its ugly self. And even though we are still in Easter season, we are also inundated with news about the brutal, bloody war in Ukraine and Sudan. We read about news of school shootings of little children. A trusty Texan with his trusty AR-15 kills 5 people because they dared come and ask him to stop shooting at night while the children were trying to sleep. And of course, poverty and economic inequalities, racism and injustice continue unchecked, and people are anxious and they're afraid, and so there are more people buying guns to protect themselves, with good reason, I guess. Well, the thing I really want to emphasize, that those glorious days that we had of Easter Sunday were nothing like the disciples of Jesus experienced on that earliest Easter Sunday. The disciples were shut up in that upper room with the doors locked for fear of their lives. Contrary to our celebrations of Easter, John reports that on Easter evening, the disciples were huddled together, not for celebration, but for fear. And while it is sometimes argued that the disciples failed Jesus with their fears, it might also be argued that Jesus failed his disciples as well. He made promises about the meek inheriting the world, but Rome, on those Easter days after the resurrection, was more secure than ever, and it was going to be secure for the next 300, 400 years. Jesus talked about loving one's enemies, only to feel the naked power of Roman power. Jesus had spoken about being lifted up in victory, but being lifted up on a cross did not seem particularly victorious to Jesus' followers. For all his promises about the coming kingdom of God, the lives of those disciples was in jeopardy. On Easter evening, on that first Easter evening, fear reigned over the apostles. And yet we read that in the midst of those apostles, Jesus came and he showed them his hands and his side, reminding them, Rome is not playing around, ladies and gentlemen. Rome means business. And then he offered them, even in the midst of that, shalom, peace, peace be with you, and tells them to forgive the sins, even of their enemies. And you'd think there would be a change with that, wouldn't you? But a week later, John reports, those disciples are still in that upper room with the doors shut and locked. The very idea of forgiving your enemy, especially when he is powerful like the Romans, seemed to be on their imaginations, as if Rome cared even one little iota whether the apostles forgave them or not for crucifying their Lord. And the very idea that Jesus now is going to send his apostles out into the world to minister in his name and to suffer along with him would be enough, I suspect, to scare even most prospective members at First Church Birmingham. I mean, that's a scary thing to give as advice for your new members. Now, there's plenty of sermon material in this gospel reading and in that Acts passage, but really what impressed me as I read this passage is not what happened in the upper room, but who was not there in the upper room. First, there was Judas, who was absent. We don't know why he was absent. We don't know why he betrayed Jesus, really. Was it for 30 meager pieces of silver? I mean, really? Or was he really trying to entice Jesus into fulfilling his mission as the Messiah who's supposed to chase those Romans out of Israel? Is that really what he believed? Actually, it doesn't make much difference. We have no idea what Judas was thinking or feeling, but what we do know is he would never hear Jesus' words of forgiveness. He would never hear Jesus' words of empowerment. He committed suicide by his own hand. He would never be charged to go out in the name of Christ and in the name of God to minister. And then there was another person absent. So there's only 10, if we all count the apostles, who were present in that upper room, and the other person who was absent was Thomas. And we don't know why he was absent either. John doesn't tell us. But what, I know, maybe it was the first opening game of the Tigers. I mean, that could have been, and he was there. Or maybe it was the last day of the Masters down in Augusta, Georgia. I had friends who made that last day down there and missed Easter. They just said, Lauren, you know, you just got to be real about this. I had free tickets. So they took them. We don't know why Thomas was not there, but we do know that because Thomas was not there in the upper room joining together with the others, he missed hearing Jesus say to him, "You are forgiven." He missed hearing peace. Well, the other people told Thomas finally, and Thomas said, "I'm not going to believe it until I see it." I mean, okay, I can understand that. He doubted. But the next week, Thomas joins them, and they are now together. And this time, Thomas is encountered by the risen Christ, and he believes. Thomas's mistake, I think, was not doubting, nor his grieving, nor his fear, nor his refusing to believe. I'm enough of a sinner and enough of a skeptic. I can understand all of that. I can appreciate all of that. I think it's natural and understandable. Thomas's mistake was his withdrawal from the fellowship of Jesus' followers for whatever reason. Often, I think we make the same mistake even in the 21st century. I've been pastor a long time. Well, not really a long time. I mean, 30 years isn't much, is it? So I'm just a young guy yet. But when I was pastor, which I haven't been for a long time, I can remember people stopping and dropping out of church and saying they were mad at the church. Of course, when they said they're mad at the church, what they really meant was they were mad at Scribner. Or they were mad at the session, or they were mad at the General Assembly, or they were mad at, I don't know, who's the church? Everybody out there that's not me. And I'm the only perfect one left. And everybody else is to blame for me leaving. Well, that was Thomas. And that was his mistake. For as long as Thomas separated himself from the body of Christ, from the church, from those apostles, he would never share in the blessings of having Jesus present in his life. And how often we make the same mistake. But just like Judas, maybe some of us sometimes are embarrassed. We lose our job, or we go through a divorce, and that's not easy for anybody, I think. It's embarrassing. Or maybe he became disillusioned, or maybe he lived by an illusion that somehow he could live by himself. I have a 10-year-old granddaughter now, but when she was 3, she is the most beautiful granddaughter this world has ever seen, and she's sweet. Well, most of the time she's sweet. But when she was 3 years old, she would say to Grandpa, "I can do it." I'd help her with her coat or her boots, and she would say to me, "I can do it. I don't need Grandma or Grandpa." And I was proud. I was proud, of course, that she could do it all by herself. But I know, and I pray that she learns one of these days, that she still needs Grandma and Grandpa, and that she still needs Mom and Dad, and she still needs her friends and her community of faith if she is going to grow strong physically and mentally and spiritually. But too often, I think in the church, we are just like that little 3-year-old. I can do it by myself. Well, whatever the reason for Thomas withdrawing from the fellowship of Jesus' presence, it resulted in his missing Jesus' words of forgiveness and hope. He missed on Jesus' assurance of promise, and he missed Jesus' charge to get with it and to minister in Jesus' name. John Calvin, I just got through teaching a course on John Calvin at our church and at a couple other churches that we did verbally or virtually, and so I have to mention him. But so I read his passage on his understanding of this, and he said, "This example is worth noticing, although the apostles act less courageously than they should have done. They do not give way to their weakness. They certainly seek concealment to escape danger, but they pluck up enough courage to remain together. Otherwise, says Calvin, they would have been scattered and none would have ever dared to look at another." And then he continues. He said, "Thomas is justly deprived of the grace given to his brethren, and it is only when he returns to that scared, weak, fallen community that Thomas too is blessed by God's presence." And then the book of Acts was read to you, and if you remember there, the disciples met and they shared all their goods while they worshiped with others who were in need. And Luke writes, every day they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread, which you're going to be doing, and the sharing of wine. Indeed, Luke tells us, "And they came, everyone, together." Luke writes, "With generous hearts, they broke bread." And then he says, "There were many being added to their number." Now, I don't know if you're an English fanatic like I am when I grade papers, but that passive participle probably is one of the most important words in the entire New Testament. They were not saved yet. They were in the process of being saved, and I think that's true of all of us. They were not perfect Christians in an ideal world, nor are we. They could still be cantankerous at times. They could still be weak. They could still be stubborn, maybe prone to gossip. Maybe they were racist sometimes. Maybe they were sexist. I don't know. But the important thing is they were together. And they came together and they opened themselves up. than to the presence of Christ in their lives. In these weeks after Easter, as we had in our confession of sin, in these weeks after Easter, I read the newspaper and I watch the television. And I see pictures of that little girl yet on that train in Ukraine, in her mother's arms, crying as they leave her daddy. And I'm devastated. Don't know about you, but wow, I just can't believe that's the world I'm leaving to my granddaughter. And it is so tempting then to lock the door and to turn off the TV and refuse to read the newspapers. And I think evidently that is what Luke and John both were aware of, the problem that was going to happen. And so they both tell us that it's not until you are together, joined together, breaking bread and sharing the cup, that you will ever be able to experience the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ in your lives. And hear Jesus say to you, as my Father has sent me, even so do I send you. And that is the reality after Easter. That is the reality that sustains us and fills us with hope in the coming of God's kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. And so today, together, as God's Easter people, on all of these Sundays after Easter and for the rest of your lives, I hope, may you walk in peace with the risen Christ and with all your brothers and all your sisters. Amen.
I invite you now to sign the friendship registration pad and let us know that you are here with us today. And I would share with you that our offering is a sign that we care for this building and the people we are worshiping with. They're a sign that we care about the world outside of this place. It is a way in which we can make a difference. And so, hearing these words from Scripture, from Hebrews 13:16, do good and share what you have, for such sacrifice is pleasing to God. Loving God, we give you thanks and praise because you love us. We find you reveal that to us in so many ways. Help us to love as you love. Accept this small offering, gifts that first came from you, but returned now to you that we might show your love and care to all the world. We pray this in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We are awaiting our young leaders. And here they are, thanks be to God. And all of you, you are invited to this table, Christ's table. Come, come and find your place at this table. Come without answers, come without knowing peace, come without preparation, come. Come and find your place here at this table. This is the table of Christ our Lord, and he prepares it for us. This is the feast that he imagines, and here peace can be found. Found in this simple meal. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Why do we give thanks at this table?
We give thanks for God's creation, for making us in God's image. We give thanks because God never gave up on us, even though we were not faithful to God. We give thanks because when it was time, God sent the only Son, Jesus, to show us God's love for us.
How can we praise God for all this?
With all the faithful of every time and place, this song is sung to God's glory. Because of the gift of the Holy Spirit, God's first gift to those who believe, who will complete God's work in the world.
Why do we eat at this table?
On the night before he died, Jesus took bread, blessed it, and gave it to his friends. He told them to eat it and remember him. And ministering in his name, we do likewise. The bread of heaven given for you.
Why do we drink from the cup at this table?
After the meal, Jesus took the cup and gave it to them as a promise that our sins are forgiven. And ministering in his name, we do likewise. The cup of salvation given for you. Let us pray that the everyday bread and juice will become holy. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these, your gifts of bread and cup, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Since this meal brings us together with all Christians, let us pray for the needs of the world and the church and all of God's children. O Holy God, we lift up to you this day the families and friends of the victims of the gun violence at the Texas Outlet Mall and in Georgia. And we pray for healing for the many people injured in both places. We pray for a change that puts an end to these types of senseless tragedy. We pray for the people of the Sudan that the ceasefire will continue and that there will be a way forward that does not threaten people's lives and livelihoods. We pray for peace wherever there is violence, fighting, or discord, including in the Ukraine, Russia, Israel, and Pakistan. We pray for the people of the United Kingdom and their newly coronated king. We pray for teachers who are in that last sprint until summer. May their energy stay strong as they take the home stretch of another school year. We pray for people who are angry, lonely, or stuck in a way of living that drains them of hope. We lift up to you those who are ill in body or mind, those who are grateful for the warming weather because they have no home and won't be so cold as they live on the streets. We pray that we will be better people, remembering that our ancestors in the faith lived in community, eating together, praying together, sharing and caring for each other. May we do likewise to the glory of your name, O God. And because we are human, we pray for those who are dearest to us, even as we are grateful that all of us are dearest to you, O God of love. And now together, let us pray the family prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, guys. Brothers and sisters, the gifts of God for the people of God. Thank you. Again, let us pray. Risen Christ, we have glimpsed you here as we have shared the bread and the cup. So help us to see you risen, present, and at work in our world. And help us to join you in making all things new until you come again in glory. And we feast again with you for all eternity. Alleluia and amen. And I think we did pretty well. Invite Tom and Barbara Russell to come forward. We're slightly over, but it's worth every second because we have the opportunity to thank a marvelous couple that have been so important to this congregation, that have done so much. Barbara is just finished up on the PNC, and the congregation. I can read, just not well. But she has been a faithful member of this church. I had the pleasure of serving communion to shut-ins with her years ago when I was first starting as a parish associate. And Tom has kept us online. With John's help and without John's help, and not just us, because I have letters. I have letters. And the letters are letters of thank you and gratitude for what Tom has done for other churches in our presbytery, helping to get them online and get their equipment, you know, working and whatnot. And just this morning, I went over and begged him to show me how to turn off the mic because my technical skills are not in equipment, but we thank you for your time with us. I know Dawn Schwarzout said that you didn't ask her and she'd like you to just stay. And I'm sure there's a number of us who have worked with them and observed their ministry across the years. But it is right and it is fitting as a congregation of the Presbyterian Church to offer up our prayers for this lovely couple And so I again ask you to join me in prayer. Loving God, thank you. Thank you for how you manifest in people and show us just how amazing you are. Your servants, Tom and Barbara, have shown many of us in many ways how deeply you love us. And we thank you for that. We are of mixed emotions as we send them off into their new adventure. Maybe we'll come and drop by and when they're down in their warm weather home. But we know their hearts, we've seen their love, and we pray, Lord, that they will have a wonderful retirement in their new warm city, and that they will know that our love follows them, surrounds them as they get settled, and as they find a new congregation to serve as faithfully as they have served this one. We thank you, Lord. Enjoy for their wonderfulness and that you have shared them with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
I had no idea in the world what it meant by sending in Christ Tom and Barb, but I wish them well. And Andrew was so wonderful. Andrew brought me the mic, or whatever that thing is called, that I hook up myself so I can speak to you out there, and I left it in the office. And so I will speak from here. I am grateful that you invited me. I charge you now to go into the world, and may peace be with you. And as you go into the world, may the peace of Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you and with all those whom you love and all those God calls you to love. Amen.